When Jesus and his disciples were in Jerusalem, they would gather together with other Jews at the temple. For centuries, the temple had been the central place for Jewish people to gather and worship God. But for some, the temple had become a place where they showed off how rich, knowledgeable, or holy they were. This made Jesus angry. Jesus warned his disciples that some of the worst offenders were in fact the religious leaders in charge of the temple. They liked to have the most important seats in the synagogues and places of honor at banquets, Jesus said. They devour widows' houses and for a show make lengthy prayers. Jesus warned that these men would eventually be punished severely for the way they acted. One day, when Jesus and his disciples went to the temple, Jesus sat down near the place in the temple where people would give money as an offering to God to support the work of the temple. As Jesus sat and watched the crowd giving their money, he observed many rich people throwing in large amounts of money. Then, a poor woman, a widow in the community, came and put in two very small copper coins, worth only a few cents. As he often did, Jesus used the moment as a way to help his disciples better understand God and God's ways. Jesus told them, "Truly I tell you, this widow has put more into the treasury than all of the others." They all gave out of their wealth, Jesus continued. But she, out of her poverty, put in everything, all that she had to live on.
How are you today? Good. It is great to see you out. Thanks for being here. I've been given directions today, all right? So we are on a time crunch, so we are just getting after it today. So check your bulletin for all detailed announcements. I'm going to hit a few highlights. But welcome today. If you are visiting New Hope, thanks for coming today. There are some visitor cards in the pew in front of you. I would love for you to get it. Fill it out. Drop it in the offering bag when it comes by later. And then next week through the mail, we'll send you information that tells you about New Hope. We promise we will not beat on your door or bother you on the phone, but through the mail, we'll send you information about what goes on around this place called New Hope. Today is an unusual Sunday. It is called Pastor Appreciation Sunday. I can promise you, the pastors did not come up with this, all right? So we're doing what we're told today, but thank you for being here on Pastor Appreciation Day. I also heard that Shelley had the audacity to have her birthday on Pastor Appreciation Day. So, happy birthday to Shelley Parker. Okay, a couple of announcements. First off, tonight we're having an evening service this evening, 6 o'clock baptism right here. We've got about 8 or 9 to baptize. We had about 12. A few had to drop out for some conflicts of schedule, but we will baptize about 8 or 9 this evening from 6 to 7. Will not be a long service, but it will be a rewarding service. We hope you'll come back and join us tonight for our baptisms. We have sign-up clipboards to go around. I'm not sure where the other one is. The ushers will find it so we can get it down the other side. There are two things on here for you to sign. One is one of the most unique things we do at New Hope is called the You Bake Sale. This is a women's ministry idea. This goes to help some of the outreach projects that women's ministry does. And here's what they're asking you to do. Put your name on here. Indicate, will you bring a cake, a pie, a dozen cookies, or brownies? Homemade, all right? That you're willing to do. And you will bring it back here on Sunday, November the 9th. 8, 9, 15, or 10:45 service. You're going to put it on a table out there. We're going to talk about it in service. And then we're going to ask that you go out and buy your dessert and take it home. And then all that goes to women's ministries. Actually, you can buy somebody else's. But it's so cool, and it's wonderful, and it goes for a great cause. So that's the first couple of sheets. Then underneath that, what you will have is, this is Angel Tree time. We're going to start thinking about helping the boys and girls who have a mom and dad or both parents that are incarcerated in prison. And as you know, we buy a gift in the name of the parent. We give it in the love of Jesus Christ. And there have been life-transforming moments with some of these kids through the years. Bill and Lindsay Eccles still have contact with the very first Angel Tree child that they took a gift to 9 years ago. And that relationship is still going on. And so we're not asking for you to pick up the angels today and to buy the gifts. That's a few weeks down the road. This is to get ready for that event. You put your name, your cell phone, your email, and say, hey, I would be willing to help out in one of these following areas. And if you don't care where you serve, they'll put you in a place, all right? But you can also indicate. You can say, I'll be part of the prayer team. We're going to become those men and women who are praying for these gifts and for the families who receive these gifts. I'll be willing to be part of the call team. I can make telephone calls to make sure we have the right address and the right names of the kids and the right sizes and to verify a time for delivery. Then there's setup. And that setup for Sundays here is we put the angels out on Christmas trees and set up for maybe one or two other events they have during that time. I'll man a table out here, all right, between services, or I'll be part of the delivery team. So if you have an area that you would indicate, so hey, if you've never done this before, what a wonderful, rewarding experience. So please sign up for both of those today. And you already got one going down. Okay, perfect. We got them. Last week, we had Operation Christmas Box with Samaritan's Purse. And the Burgers did a great job sharing that with us. And 200 boxes went out, all right? And those will be returned and going all around the world by Christmas time to help kids in other countries celebrate the love and the life of Christ at Christmas time. This coming Friday evening, 6 o'clock, right out there in our parking lot. How many of you saw the ad in the newspaper, the article, I should say? Yeah, good article. This is the brainchild of Amanda Christensen, and she is stoked about it. It's our first time ever to do it. Probably a lot of mistakes have been made, but it's the first of what we hope will be an ongoing thing for years to come, where we will join with other churches in the community, just have a night of music and worship out in the parking lot. There's going to be food trucks out there, snow cone truck, yogurt truck. There's going to be some activities for kids and four different worship bands from four different churches in this region of Fresno. Clovis are going to share together a half hour of music for each one of them with a little break in between. Ours will be the last one. We kind of want to make sure that we are prepared, so we're asking the churches today to take a raise of hands of those who are going to come out. You don't have to stay all 3 hours. Great if you want to. You can bring your own lawn chair, all right? Or you can use the chairs that are provided. But if you'll be coming for part of the evening, Friday night, would you raise your hand and keep it raised for a few minutes, all right? You're going to come out on Friday night. Okay, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 8, 9, 21, 31, 30, yep. Hold them up until I get past you. All right. 30, 31, 32, 33, 34, 35, 36, 37, 38, 39, 40, 41, 42, 43. Okay, I'm going to say about 70 in here. All right? So that's good. 70 in here. We had 20 in our 8 o'clock service. So, Sam, that's 90. That's 90 now. All right, Sam's my mathematician back there. Great. Now, that's Hope Fest. If you haven't been fested enough, come back on Sunday, and we'll fest you a little bit more because we're going to have Harvest Fest after the 10:45 service. Lunch here on the grounds. Free lunch, all right? Freshly barbecued tri-tips and the side dishes and activities for the kids out in the grass area in preparation for Halloween week. And it's just our way of celebrating on that Sunday. So you got to eat lunch somewhere. You might as well eat free. And it's a great way to meet other folks in church and just have a great time of fellowship. So you all in the 9:15 service, you can go home, change clothes, go sip a latte, and then come back at 12:15 and have lunch here at the church, okay? At this time, I'm going to ask our ushers to come prepare to wait on us as we have our morning tithes and offerings, and I'm going to ask you to join with me, if you would please, in our prayer. Our Father, we thank you for life and for sharing your life with us. We commit to you the needs of those who've recently had surgery and are recovering, and for those who are going through ongoing therapy. They're going through treatment. We pray for strength in their bodies, and we pray for strength in their emotions as they go through these challenges. Father, thank you for what you want to say and speak into our hearts today. May we give you our undivided attention. And then, Father, may we surrender to you our wills. And if you challenge us with something that seems difficult, may we remember that all you ask is our permission. You'll provide the power to accomplish that which you demand. And so, Father, may you find within us just simply a willing heart. Thank you, Father, for all that will be said and done today. May you be glorified. Lord, as man spends a little time today honoring other men, may we maintain a sense of humility. But, Father, most of all, may this be about you and not about us. For the privilege of giving and sharing, we say thanks. We commit all this to you in the incredible name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. I'd like to introduce to you the chairman of the New Hope Board, John Longstaff, and he is going to be directing the rest of this service until the sermon.
I don't get to preach?
Actually, you look more like preaching today than I do, so I'll give you my notes if you would like.
It's a mistake, trust me. It's a mistake.
All right.
Once again, welcome and good morning. We have a special honor this morning, and that is to show our gratitude and appreciation for what we're going to refer to as the Wall of Fame over here. For those of you that are new to New Hope and may not be familiar with these gentlemen, I'm going to ask you to pay particular attention to the handout in the bulletin this morning, and you certainly can read up on what a gift we have here at New Hope, as well as what these gentlemen do for the community. The spouses of these men are also often overlooked or overshadowed by the busyness of ministry itself, but quite frankly, it takes two and a united two to serve Jesus Christ together as a team, and for that we are grateful to each of the spouses as well. Ladies, we thank you. As well this morning, I am told that we've been given 55 minutes. Is that correct? Pretty close. We're going to try and make this as quick as we can in light of the Believe series. And we want to assure you that due to the brevity of this, it is not to take away from our appreciation for many of these pastors. Today, this worship is going to be made up and tailored to each of these gentlemen's favorite hymns. So let's get going. Pastor Gil Hernandez, would you please join me up here? And I'm going to warn you, somebody played a trick and they waxed these things, so you may slide right into my lap unknowingly. But there you go. Gil, you selected Overshadowed, and I've been asked to ask you for a brief, I emphasize brief, is only 7 pages. That's good. Explanation of how you picked this particular hymn and what it's meant to you.
Okay, the word really overshadowed is used 3 times in the New Testament in the King James Version, which I read constantly. But as I read about the transfiguration of the Lord Jesus Christ, the heaven is open. And as heaven opens, you hear the voice from heaven, the Father's voice, "This is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased." I'm going to read the rest. Mark's account at the moment, Jesus may have stepped back into heaven's open door when that door opened up. But he turned his back on the joy of the Father's home and set his face to endure the cross, that he might become not only the example, but the redeemer of men. Therefore, I stand in awe at his presence, in his presence, and am overshadowed by his mighty love.
Let's hear Overshadowed. Please.
How desolate my life would be, how dark and dear my nights and days, if Jesus' face I did not see, too bright in all my weary ways. I'm overshadowed by his mighty love eternal, changeless, pure. I'm overshadowed by his mighty love. Rest is my serene, secure. He died to ransom me from sin. He lives to keep me day by day. I'm
Gil, as a token of New Hope's thanks for you and your service to not only Jesus Christ, but to our community, thank you very much. I'd also like to ask you to please take a rose and a gift for your bride, and we'd love to see you just go plant a big old kiss on her is what I'd like to see. But that's me. Perfect. Thank you, Gil. Next, we have Rich Smith. I'm going to warn you about this waxed environment here, or you and I will be meeting in ways we've never met, Rich. The hymn you've chosen is How Great Thou Art. Again, briefly, would you like to share how that has impacted your life? Did I say briefly?
Briefly.
Yeah, thank you.
Yes. That hymn is important to me because I think one of the struggles of the church today is that we trivialize God and make him to be a compassionate grandfather when really he's the creator of the universe, and he truly is awesome and powerful and mighty, and that hymn reflects that.
Very well spoken. Any questions? Beautiful hymn. Once again, on behalf of New Hope Community Church, thank you for your service to Jesus Christ as well as to this community. We thank you so much, and we're so proud to have you. I'm also going to ask you to grab a rose and a gift. And this time it's your choice if you want to give Virginia a kiss. It's not up to me anymore.
Yes.
It's beyond my control. Like I ever had any control. Robert Hutchinson, come on down, Minnie. And I'm going to scoot this closer because we haven't had a chat in a while. You've selected Sweet By and By, and I'm once again going to ask that you share briefly what this hymn means to you and how it's affected your life.
Well, my hymn, my favorite hymn changes according to the things that I go through. So year to year, it might be different from the last. This last year, I lost my grandmother. She lost a battle to cancer, but she won her seat next to Jesus. She used to sing this song to me while cuddled up in her arms. So this year it's Sweet By and By.
Wow. On behalf of New Hope Community Church, I thank you for your service to Jesus Christ, to this community and to this church. And I can say personally to me, I thank you. I as well am going to ask you to grab a rose and a gift for your bride. And I think we've started a tradition here, so if you break it, it's your issue. Gene Sperling. Yeah, I was going to say. The hymn that you've selected is No Other Plea. And I am pretty much committed to asking you to briefly share how this has impacted you and how you came to choose it.
When I was a young man, like many, I struggled with the assurance of my salvation. One day I was convinced I was saved. The next, because of the doofus that I am, I was convinced that I wasn't. And it was finally the singing of this hymn that solidified it for me. I need no other evidence. I need no other plea. It is enough that Jesus died and that he died for me. Now, since that time, that hymn has been replaced with the truth of Scripture. And since the time is short, 1 John 5:11, 12, and 13. This is the testimony. God has given to us eternal life. This life is in his Son. He who has the Son has the life. He who does not have the Son does not have life. I write these things to you who believe in the name of the Son of God, that you may know that you have eternal life.
What a testimony. Gene, please accept this very humble gift from us at New Hope Community Church. Thank you for your service to Jesus Christ as well as to the entire community. Again, thank you for being my friend. I'm going to ask you to please grab a rose and a gift, and may the trend be unbroken.
What do I do with it now?
My short-term memory is fine. Pastor Lonnie Rowland, Pops, if you would please join me. What a stud muffin. He can't help it. Thank you. Victory in Jesus. I wonder how you came upon that hymn.
Well, because that he died.
Get you off that.
He rose again. And I know that one day I'll be able to join him in heaven and be with my spouse that's gone on. So there'll be victory again through the Lord Jesus Christ as our personal Savior.
About as simple as it gets, huh?
Yep.
In addition, I don't think there's any way that we can finish this without mentioning what a part June has been in your total ministry and the ministry of this church. So, in full recognition of that, I would like you to take a rose today, and if you be visiting the cemetery, if you would take that with you and share our love for her and continued hopes that she's still running heaven the way that she ran this church. So, again, a loving gift for you. Thank you. Let me see, who do we have next? Where are you going? Our senior pastor, Tim Rowland, is making his home run trot over here to the... Leave that there, or unless you're going to say something.
I have my notes.
Oh, did emphasize brief?
46 pages.
46 pages later. So you've selected wonderful piece. Can you briefly share with me or share with all of us how that's impacted your life and how you came to choose that particular hymn? Briefly.
Have I ever briefly shared anything?
That was the fear.
Yeah. I think maybe the greatest need that all of us have is internal peace. And most of us get that disrupted by circumstances in our life. And this song is a song that tells us there is a peace that is available to all of us that is not dependent upon what's going on around us. The chorus says, "It comes down from the Father above. Sweep over my spirit forever I pray in fathomless billows of love." And there have been occasions at broken times in my life when this hymn has been sung, that it has just overflowed, and God has made himself very real and very personal, and that peace is a treasure, and in that peace, as the last verse says, I can rest every single night in that wonderful peace. Amen. One of my favorites.
Padre and best friend, I ask you to please accept this on behalf of New Hope Community Church for what it is you do, not only for Jesus Christ, but for our entire community. I personally thank you. I don't think there's anybody here that couldn't also give you that personal thanks.
Thank you.
You have the honor of that last rose, and what you do with it is going to be public record.
You knocked my ear thing off.
Personal problems again. May I ask you pastors to please join me down front? It's a photo op. You know how that is. And I'm getting out of this picture, by the way. Gentlemen, once again, thank you so very much for what it is that you offer us as a community of New Hope, but more importantly, what you do for the Church of Jesus Christ and our Father, and for this community of Clovis and Fresno. Gentlemen, another standing ovation.
And by the way, to all you pastors, all those gifts they gave you, you got to give them back because they have to do that one more time. Kind of the problem about, you know, multiple services. I am so grateful that before John left, he didn't tell me I had to be brief with the sermon. I thought that was funnier than you all did. I learned something today. You cannot buy McDonald's French fries before 11 a.m. in the morning. I drove through the drive-up at about 7:35 today, and I said, I want a super-sized box of French fries. And they said, we don't serve them before 11. I said, I need them for a sermon illustration. And they said, we don't serve them before 11. So I said, okay, I'll just have to drive through the window. Well, while I'm waiting for two other people to get their whatever they get at breakfast time, when I pulled up, I said, could I just buy a box? Since you don't have French fries, I'd like to buy a box. Three people told me I couldn't buy a box of empty French fries, all right? Then one of them said, they gave me the little paper one, all right? And I said, no, it's not big. I need to hold it up, all right? This is illustrative. And so then they brought me out the medium one and said, we can give it. I said, no, I want the super-sized box. And she said, we can't give that. I said, why? I said, I don't want you to give it. I'm going to pay you for it. And they said, you're going to pay me for an empty box of French fries? I said, yeah, because you're not making French fries. I want the box. And she said, well, I can't give it to you because we got a Monopoly sticker on it, all right? I said, ma'am, charge me for the box. I have to preach a sermon. So, if in the next offering you'd like to add a little bit to cover the $2.38 it cost me for this box, all right? So anyway, that's the story behind the box. Pardon me? Yeah, I needed to sing Wonderful Peace right about that moment in the drive-thru. But anyway, today I'm going to enlist the help of this imaginary box of French fries to help us understand the theme that we are in Believe, Key Truth Number 9 this morning. And I have to tell you, I think either the folks who planned today gave in to a bit of their evil nature in choosing this Sunday in October to be Pastor Appreciation Sunday, knowing that the message today in here, I don't control the order of this. This is done by the weeks that we're doing here. I'm going to be less appreciated by the time this sermon is over because it's about stewardship. Everybody hates it when the preacher preaches on stewardship because he's always talking about money. Now, if you are new at New Hope, know something. Until 18 months ago, in almost 30 years of ministry, I had never preached a message on money. I've preached two, all right? That's it. So this doesn't happen very often. And the good news is, it's not all about money. It's about something far bigger and even more important than just money. But the subject, how many of you read chapter 9 in your Believe Bibles? Okay, terrific. How many of you will get caught up next week? All right. Some of y'all are way, way behind, all right? You need a night of reading, but that's okay. So here's the reason I want to use McDonald's super-sized box of French fries is every time you have a French fry, I hope you will think about today's key truth. That's why I wanted a box of French fries. Now, some of you may never go back to McDonald's again after today, but I want you to think about what we're going to talk about today. One day, James wanted to do something special with his son, 5-year-old Johnny. He asked him, son, is there anything you'd like to do right now? And Johnny said, yeah, Dad, I want some McDonald's French fries. His father said, that's what my boy wants. That's what my boy gets. So they got into their blue-white Chevy pickup. They headed towards McDonald's, and Johnny's lips and tongue were silently moving as he could taste those fries before they ever reached the store. His dad placed the order, and Johnny's heart pounded when his dad said, supersize those fries. James took the money out of his wallet, paid for the fries and the drink, and Johnny's little teeth were ready to sink into those hot, golden fries before they ever got to the table. Y'all getting hungry yet? That's why I wanted him here. I wanted that smell to just waft through the sanctuary, all right? When they sat down, grace consisted of this. God bless this food, amen. It seemed like far too many words to Johnny, who was eager to delight himself with this huge blessing of French fries. James was happy to see his little boy so happy over something so simple. He decided to join in the fun, and he reached over to get a couple of Johnny's fries. To his surprise, his son quickly put his arms around the fries like he was building a fort. And he pulled all of them closer to his chest and he said, no, these are mine. His dad was in a state of shock for a moment. He could not believe what just happened. James pulled back his hand and began to reflect about his son's attitude towards those fries. Let's kind of walk together through things that went through that dad's mind. Dad was thinking, my son has failed to realize that I am the source of those fries. At the counter, I was the one who took out my wallet and money out of my wallet, and I didn't give him the size of the fry he thought he was going to get. I gave him twice as big as he expected. Yet he's pulling those fries away from me. Not only was I the source of those French fries, my son forgot that I'm 6'2", 200 pounds, and I have the power to take those fries away from him. Or that if I wanted, I could go back to that counter and bring him so many fries that he would never want another fry again. He also does not understand that I don't need his French fries. I could, again, go back to that counter and get as many fries as I wanted to eat. As the dad thought about it, one or two fries really would not make a difference for him that day. What he wanted from his son, Johnny, was to be invited into this wonderful little world that he had made possible for his son. He wanted his son to be willing to share the very blessing that he as the father had provided. Today, as we talk about good stewards, we have to realize that every day God gives to you and me the choice to live out the chance to never underestimate Him. God takes us to McDonald's on a regular basis in our lives. He blesses us. He blesses you and He blesses me. He's given all of us some French fries. Sometimes in the small bag, in the medium bag, and sometimes, man, they're supersized. Some are skinny and light in color like McDonald's, and others are thick like Raley's, and some are straight and some are curly like Wendy's, but God gives us fries all the time. Like that dad, God desires to sit down at the table with us for some fellowship. When God reaches over to use some of the blessings that He has given to us, far too often we build a fort with our arms and say, no, God, mine! Mine! We're trying to build our own little fort of security for our blessings. And Jesus is left standing at a door. It's Revelation 3:20 says, I stand at the door and I knock. And I'm waiting for my son, for my daughter, for my child to open the door and let me come in and have some fries with them. And often we say, no, God. No, God. Is there anybody here this morning that understands that God is the source of all that we have? Is there anybody here this morning that understands God has the ability and even the right to take away everything that we think is ours? Do you also realize that God has the ability to give us far more than we already have? He can supersize it anytime He wants to. Is there anybody here that recognizes God does not need the French fries He's provided for us, but that it's an honor and a privilege to be able to share our fries with God so God might want to use us to share fries with others? God does not ask us to give because God is hurting and is in need. God asks us to give because God wants us to be like Him. God wants His DNA to be reflective in our nature. The first verse that most of us ever memorized out of the Bible was a verse that really gets to the heart of this issue. It's John 3:16. For God so loved the world that He gave supersized fry, let me tell you. He gave the biggest and the best. Throughout the Bible, you find that God is always giving. In our own lives, how many of you know that you cannot underestimate God's ability to provide for us in ways that we didn't know were possible? God is very interested in our response to the blessings that He sends our way. And He's very interested in what we choose to do with how we have been blessed. Listen to this verse out of Psalm 24. It's on the opening page of the ninth chapter of Believe. And it says, the earth is the Lord's and some of the things in it. Good, you're paying attention. The Lord is the earth and everything in it is His. He bought the fries. For He founded it on the seas and He established it on the waters. Typically, when we talk about this word stewardship in church environments anyway, people began to immediately connect putting money in an offering plate, causing our minds to go quickly to our wallets and our purses. We think about handing over money, and both the definition and the connotation become very narrow and very negative for us. We all of a sudden start to shut the preacher off because, oh no, here it comes again. You see, the idea of handing over rather than holding on to our money is a struggle for so many. While giving money to the church, including the idea of tithing, that's tithing, there's no other way to cut tithing, but it's 10%. It's defined. And guys, just let me pause here. I didn't write what's in this book. I hope you know when you come here on a Sunday morning, I do not preach what my ideas are. If I do ever do that, go find another church quickly. If I ever preach to you anything other than what is found in the contents and the context of God's holy word, then you need to run. I am not the one who said all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. I don't know about you, but I don't like the idea of being defined as a sinner. I kind of abhor it. The fact I don't like it doesn't change the fact of it. That is what God said. And God said, in spite of the fact that you were a sinner, I love you so much that while you were engaged in your sinful practices, I sent my Son, the Lord Jesus, to die for you so I can have a personal relationship with you. It's the reason we're doing this in the order in which we are. We would not talk about stewardship first. That would be foolish. We first of all talked about God. Does He exist? Do we believe in Him? We then talked about this God who is, who always has been, who always will be. And there's evidence historically as well as biblically that He is. Then we talked about this incredible God wants to be personal with you. And the way this incredible God is personal with us is through a thing called salvation. He will forgive us. He has taken care of the penalty. And He said, I want a relationship with you if you want a relationship with me. And here's how it works. And then He said, the way you can find out about me and the way you can find out about how personal I want to be with you and how you can find out how to have salvation with me is you believe in my book called the Bible. You study it and you read it and you follow it and you trust it and you obey it. And He said, then once you have discovered who I am in the Bible, He said, then you find out what your fellowship is like and it's called the church. And you function together to make a difference in the world in which I provided for you. He explains to us about our humanity, so even though we are now saved and have a personal relationship with Him, we understand how sometimes there's conflicts in our life, the things I want to do, I don't do, and the things I don't want to do, I do, and that's where I end up. And life's a struggle. And then He talks to us about stewardship. Well, first, compassion. And then he brings us to the subject of stewardship. You see, if we don't believe those first seven or eight things that are in here, throw stewardship out the window. There's a wall of truth out here we've asked you to sign when you believe all 10 things. And I knew that many would not sign that until after we've been through all 10 because they're unsure about some of them. And the one I was pretty confident that most would be unsure about is this one that we're on today, that everything I am and everything I own is God's. And there are many of us who know that truth in our head, but it hasn't traveled the 12 inches to our heart. And that is what we want to kind of talk about today. I want us to have a bigger and broader perspective. So here's the key question. How much does God want of me? The bottom line is God wants all that you are, and he wants everything that you have. The answer to this key question is this: 100%. And by the way, folks, it's non-negotiable. I love to dicker and debate. I love to go try to... Jerry. Stumbled there for a moment. Jerry, she is good at dickering. She is good to get a price down. I've seen her in action. All right, she's good. I've tried to learn some tips. All right, but and I like doing that. But here's the deal, folks. God doesn't dicker. God does not negotiate. God provided the fries, and he said, "Just as I've given you all that I am, I want you to give to me all that you are." And some are saying, well, why would God want all of me? I mean, you know, why? The simple and obvious answer is that everything we think is ours is already his anyway. He's waiting for our attitude to catch up with his purpose. But the deeper and more personal answer is because the best opportunity for us, as well as for all of us around us, is to understand God's principle and purpose. That is the best for us. Gamblers want an inside tip on what horse to bet on. Investors want an inside tip on what stocks to invest their money on. Coaches want an inside tip on how they can defeat their opponent. Do you want an inside tip on life? Give it all to God. It's his anyway. Just give it to him. Don't hold back. You see, it's not enough to believe something is the right answer. We must believe it as a way of living our lives. The journey of belief begins in our head, but it must migrate those 12 inches south to the heart to make a difference in the way we live. Because we live out of the issues of our heart. We live consistently with the beliefs that are embraced in our heart. Proverbs 23:7, a very frequently quoted scripture. As a person thinks in their heart, so are they. I know it says he, but I'm trying to make this gender sensitive today. As a man thinks, so is he. As a woman thinks, so is she. As a person thinks, so we are. Do you know, as long as I've known that verse, until this week, I never paid attention to the context of the verse. I didn't know what was right before it. Listen to this. This is found in the book of Proverbs, chapter 23, verses 6 through 8. All right? Do not eat the bread of a miser. You know what a miser is? Some of you are shaking your head. Who wants to give me a really good... a hoarder? Yeah, a hoarder. A Scrooge? Yeah, cheapskate. There we go. A miser is a cheapskate. All right? He knows how to pinch a penny, man, until it squeals. Do not eat the bread of a miser, nor desire his delicacies, for he, as he thinks in his heart, so is he. Eat and drink, he says to you. But his heart is not with you. The morsel you've eaten, he's going to want you to vomit it up and give it back. Suppose you spend the night at a house of a person you don't know very well. Before he leaves in the morning for work, he tells you, hey, help yourself to whatever's in the refrigerator. And so you do. You have some cereal and some milk on it and, you know, a little sugar, and there's some fruit in there, and you put some fruit on your cereal and you have breakfast just like he told you that you should. And then he comes home that afternoon and he gives you the cold shoulder, and you ask him, hey, did I do something wrong? And he says, no. But later in the week you hear through the gossip of friends that in fact he was angry with you because you raided his refrigerator. And you respond to your friends, well, man, that can't be. He told me it was okay. And after your friends chuckle a bit, one of them quips, it doesn't matter what he says. Everybody knows he's a miser. He can't help himself. Your host knows the proper thing to say is to offer the contents of the fridge. However, when it comes right down to the truth, he really doesn't embrace that notion in his heart. He's a miser. He lives consistently with the values and the principles of a begrudging host. He just can't help himself. Why? Because the belief resides in his heart. He says up here he ought to share, but in his heart he wants to hold. Jesus reinforces that axiom when he said, "Where your treasure is, there will your heart be also." The miser's greed hurt him, his relationship with his friends, and his reputation. Giving all we have to God not only offers freedom to our souls, but it blesses our lives, but it also blesses those that we encounter in our circle of influence as well. There's only one passage in all of Scripture, from Genesis to Revelation, where God invites you and I to test him. It's in this matter of stewardship. It's found in Malachi chapter 3, verses 10 through 12. He says, bring the whole tithe. Not 3% or 5%, but he said, bring all of it. That's all 10. Bring it to the storehouse, that there may be food in my house. Test me in this, says the Lord Almighty, and see if I will not throw open the floodgates of heaven and pour out so much blessing you won't have enough room to put it. I will prevent pests from devouring your crops, and vines in your fields will not drop their fruit before they're ripe, says the Lord Almighty, and all the nations will call you blessed, for yours will be a delightful land. This passage is full of personal language from God, offering powerful promises of blessing to those who would obediently give to the Lord. He shows us that he's able to do in the life of a faithful steward. Jesus taught frequently about this spiritual dynamic, including the words in the Sermon on the Plateau, as recorded in Luke 6:38. That's the Sermon on the Mount. I'm just kind of being funny. Jesus said, give, and it will be given you. Give a good measure, pressed down, shaken together, running over, and it'll be poured out in your lap. For with the measure you use, it will be measured to you. When you give like this, it'll be given like this. When you give like you'll receive that way. As we can see, God is serious about this matter, so let's introduce our key idea for the day. The key idea is this: I believe everything I am and everything I own belongs to God. If we agree that 100% of all that we are comes from God, then a begrudging attitude towards him in sharing all that he gives us will smack of the miser. And the Apostle Paul writes this in 2 Corinthians 9, 6-8. He says, remember this. When somebody says remember, that means, hey, what I'm about to tell you is kind of important. Okay? Sam? He might be outside counting. Okay. See, I told him, remember how many we counted today. That's important for somebody to know. What Paul's about to tell us is, remember this. Whoever sows sparingly will reap sparingly. Whoever sows generously will reap generously. Each of you should give what you have decided in your heart to give, not reluctantly or under compulsion. For God loves a cheerful giver, and God is able to bless you abundantly, so that in all things, at all times, having all that you need, you will abound in every good work. Notice the all and the every. Paul adds an important principle to this giving. In the Old Testament, it was legislated. In the New Testament, it's to be grace-filled. The law has not changed. The attitude should. So hold on to it till you can give gracefully. I shared in that sermon a year and a half ago or so about personal life and personal experience in giving. I was not always, even as a pastor, faithful in my tithing and my giving. God worked on my heart in several ways, and I'll share some of that in just a minute. But when Shelley and I married, that became a priority. And we started at the minimum. And as most of you know, as pastor of New Hope, my desire has always been that as a church, we give twice a tithe away. That 20% of what comes in here goes back out to missions and ministries, to take it to Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, the uttermost parts of the earth. To take it from Fresno to the depraved people in Fresno. Are you guys awake? Okay, that was kind of humorous. To Sacramento, to Colombia, to the Ivory Coast, and anywhere in between and beyond. And last year, for the first time, we finally hit 20.04%. It was awesome. But that's not only been a desire as a pastor for a church, it's been a desire as a husband with a wife. And each year of our married life, our percentage is inching closer and closer. I couldn't do that for a lot of years without grudge, without angst. What a joy it is when we can turn loose of it, because you know what? It's not mine to begin with. There are two important points about this passage. Sow sparingly, reap sparingly. Give what you've decided, not reluctantly or out of compulsion, but out of a grace-filled heart. Paul's teaching parallels God's challenge in Malachi. Sow sparingly, it'll come back that way. Secondly, the decision for what we should give is made in the heart, for this is the catalyst of action. In the sermon recorded by Matthew, Jesus said, "For where your treasure is, there will your heart be also." I think, interestingly, the converse of this scripture is true as well. Where your heart is, you'll discover what you treasure. Let's expand now to the true definition and the big picture of stewardship. The biblical idea is that through a relationship with God, we move from being the title of owner to the position of manager. A steward is simply a manager. We deed over to God ownership of all things in our life, both external and internal. And then we take on the management of all that He gives. This means not only the physical, the money, the house, the cars, and the resources, but this also means our gifts, our talents, our personality, our intellect, our emotions. That means I can give over to God my anger. I don't have to own it by myself anymore. It means I can give over the debt of my bitter spirit that I have towards family who have abused me and hurt me. I can give that over to Him. Why? Because I'm not the owner anymore. I'm just the manager. So God, here it is. You want to do with it what you want to. I get to give Him my debts as well as my profits. One of the growing trends in business over the past 20 years is this particular scenario. A corporation takes notice of a smaller company that has a similar business and decides that the smaller company might really benefit from having a larger firm overshadow it. The corporation approaches the company owner and says, "We'd like to buy your business, take over your debt, offer you our resources, hire you and your staff to run it for us. We own you, but you get to manage it, and you don't have all the frustrations of the debt." For the small business owner, the thought of shifting the constant strain of dealing with day-to-day finances to someone else, concentrating on satisfying customers, is attractive. This method of growth for large companies has become fairly commonplace. Obviously, there are some complications that can show up and challenges in making these ventures work, but many have succeeded quite well. And when they do, everybody wins. And this is exactly the concept of stewardship in a modern-day example. You own your own life, but your business might be quite dysfunctional and deeply in debt. Christ comes to you and says, "I'm offering to buy you out. I'm willing to redeem your life, forgive your sin, pay off all that you owe that you never could repay. I will give you all of my resources of heaven, and you can then manage what I give to you." And in this transaction, what do you owe Him in return? As stewards, we give to Him our lives, our resources, for our good and for His glory. Love Him, love the neighbor as we love ourselves with all that we are and all that we have. What's the key application here? What difference does this idea that all that I am belongs to God make in the way in which I live life today? Here's what it does. We move from owner to manager. And my central question now becomes, what does God want me to do with all the resources He's put into my hands? And some of you are saying, "Whoa, Tim, you haven't seen my portfolio lately. There's nothing to manage." Really? Really? You have nothing to manage in life? Well, if you would say that, then what do you have to own? If you have nothing to manage, what are you holding so tightly to what you own for? But I want you to realize you have a whole lot that God has given to you. Let me highlight a few things. How are you handling the stewardship of your worship? Do you manage a daily lifestyle of worshiping God for who He is? You've been given that privilege to worship Him with the dawning of every new day and say, "God, this is your day. I want to honor you with my life." How are you handling that one? How are you managing and stewarding your prayer life? Do you live a lifestyle of a running conversation with God? Is your first response to every situation in life is, God, what do you want? Jesus said, seek ye first the kingdom of God and all these things will be added to you. What are the things? If you go back and read the context, you'll see he's talking about food, and he's talking about fashion, and he's talking about fellowship. He's talking about the things in this world. If we seek him first, he'll give us direction and leadership. Prayer. How you handle that? I love God's sense of humor. I mean, one, our world needs a lot of prayer right now. We've got headlines that list Ebola and ISIS. And it's fearing folks with fear and anxiety. Last night before I went to bed, I just want to have a routine. Doesn't take very long to accomplish the routine, but every night, kind of as I climb into bed, I have a routine. I take my phone off my hip and I plug it in so it's fully charged the next morning. And as I'm plugging it in, I do a couple of things. One is I make sure my alarm is set so I get up at the correct time that morning. Number two, I look to see what the weather's going to be like so I can anticipate what I will wear the following day. And then I look at texts and emails real quick. Did I get something at the last minute that I missed that might be very, very important? Vast majority of the time, the answer is no, but sometimes there is something there that I need to address. Last night, as I went to bed, I had just received an email from Max Licato. Randy Frazee, Max, pastor of the church where Believe and the Story came from. Max wanted to tell me about this point in my sermon. Now, I'm not the only one who got that email. Everybody on his email list who gets his daily devotion probably got the same email. We will send it out through our church network today, but listen to what he wrote. I love God's timing just before this morning's sermon. Pray first. Join Max for a live online prayer gathering Monday, 4 p.m. Pacific Standard Time. You see, he said, we are unaccustomed to such images. Health workers clad in head-to-toe protective gear, emergency response team loaded and unloading patients into a waiting ambulance, a journalist kneeling in the desert wearing an orange jumpsuit and a somber face, standing over him a man in a mask wielding a blade, then using it to do the unthinkable. Ebola, ISIS, world plague, barbarism. Are we living in a science fiction novel? Parents want to protect their kids. Kids want to protect their parents. Hospitals want to help the sick. The world seems on edge. We feel helpless. Is there anything we can do? Absolutely, if we're good stewards. It's time for us to pray. Here's Max's idea. Let's have an online prayer gathering of believers all around the world. Live stream Monday, October 20th, 6 to 6:30 CST time, 4 to 4:30 Pacific Standard Time. We will join our hearts together and ask God to help us. Would you like to join? Can you help get the word out? Ask the church to announce it. Use social media outlets. Tell your friends. Share the link. And pray first. We really need to pray. Prayer is a pathway to solidarity. Rather than pointing fingers or casting blame, let's bend our knees and pray together. None of us has all the solutions, but all of us can pray. All of us all over the world, we are in this thing called life together. Let's kneel together and pray. Prayer leads to peace, to wonderful wonderful peace coming down from the Father above. According to Paul, the first fruit of prayer is this kind of peace. Let your requests be made known to God, and the peace of God will guard your hearts. Let's take a stand against panic. Nothing good comes from a raging sense of fear. The best decisions are made in an atmosphere of calm. Prayer helps create this atmosphere. Prayer impacts the heart of God. For James wrote, the effective, fervent prayer of a righteous man avails much. Scripture is replete with this assurance. Pray, don't lose hope. When two gather in my name and make a prayer out of it, my Father in heaven goes into action. Our prayers matter. Most likely you won't be researching ways to cure the virus or to defeat the terrorists, but all of us can pray. Let's join our hearts. Let's pray tomorrow. I'll figure out how to do this. One, you can pray at home. You can go online. I'm going to give you the info here in just a second. You want to come and join some others of us? I'm going to be over in the other building at 4 o'clock. Robert's going to tell me how I can do this, because I have no idea. But I'm going to give it to you real quick. We'll post it later. So if you don't get it the first time, I don't have time to repeat it. www. Max Lucado, maxlucado.com/thingy. Pray first. All that run together. Wherever you are in the world, log on. Let's pray together. How are you handling the stewardship, the management of worship and of prayer? How are you handling your emotions? Y'all got them. You may not have money in your bank account, but you've got emotions in your heart. Do you own those emotions, or are you managing those emotions? Is bitterness boiling over in your life, or are you abounding in love? Are you bouncing in a sea of resentment, or are you cruising in the spirit of good, of God's goodwill? Are you always angry, or is contentment a constant companion in your life? The answer to those questions will determine whether you still are taking ownership or if you have relinquished ownership and said, God, I'll manage under your authority. Rest. How about rest in your life? How are you managing that? God's big into rest. He created 6 days and he rested on the seventh. He didn't need to, but he set a pattern for us. Have you RSVP'd to the invitation you've been sent lately? See, Jesus gave an invitation when he said, come to me, all of you who are tired and weary and beaten down, and I will provide rest for your soul. Notice Jesus did not say, go to bed and sleep. Jesus said, come to me. Notice he didn't say, go on vacation. How many of you ever gone on vacation and came back more tired at the end of vacation than before you ever left? Yeah. It doesn't work. Because most of us are stressed out, how are we going to pay for this thing I just enjoyed? No rest. So,
Group 1 took up the collection. Here's your $2.30.
If I do that in 3 services, I'll make $7.50. All right, that's good. Thank you, Governor. That's about what I would expect from Governor Brown as well, all right, for all my investment. It's about $2 worth. He didn't say go to bed. He didn't say go on vacation. He said come to me. He did not say run away and escape. He said come to me. How are you handling the resource of rest in your life? There are other resources we have. I don't have much time to deal with, but you've got talents, abilities, and availability. Finances. I learned my lessons from a widow's mite and a widow's meal and a little boy's sack lunch. Dr. John Brodus, on one memorable Sunday, as the ushers were taking the offering, the pastor left the platform and he walked down to where the ushers were collecting the plate. And the pastor walked down every row and he watched as the people put their gifts in. He did it on every row. That's a little awkward, isn't it? That guy's got more courage than I've got. After he finished, he said, I've seen every dime and nickel and dollar. I know some of you are upset or angry. Some of you are probably confused. Some are shamefaced. Some you're filled with amazement. All of you were surprised. But he said, my people, if you take to heart that I have seen your stewardship this day, I have seen the sacrifices you've made and the sacrifices you've not made, remember the Son of God, our Savior, is in every aisle and every service of every day. He knows. It was the widow's mite that triggered that thought. Jesus sat on a stool at the door. And everybody who entered the temple dropped their tithe then. And in those days, somebody actually sat there and kept a count. Jesus sat next to him that one Sunday, Sabbath day. And the last one through the line was a widow. She dropped in 2 mites, 2 brass coins that might have a value today of 2 cents. And Jesus said for everybody to hear, she's given more than anybody. People looked at him surprised, and he said, you gave out of your abundance. She gave all out of her poverty. That's the story that changed the course of my giving. There's a story in the Old Testament of a widow's meal. She was going to make one last cake, lay down with her son, and die. And Elijah, the prophet of God, said, God told me to come here and that you'd provide me something to drink. And she said, I'll get you some water. And as she's going to get water, he said, while you're there, make me a cake. She looked at him and said, sir, I have enough for one meal. My son and I will eat it and die. I can't make you a cake. He said, God told me to tell you, make me a cake. I got to be honest. God might have to send me that message with a lightning bolt before I could say that to a widow woman. And she did. She obeyed. And Elijah said, because of your obedience to God, your barrel will never be empty. Your bottle of oil will never run dry. She never went and found a full barrel or a full bottle, but every time she went to make a meal, there was just enough for another meal. I saw that play out in Africa with medicine. The first year that I went, the container didn't arrive, and we were told the very first day, we may not have enough medicine to do more than one day's worth of surgery. And by the end of 10 days, we did more surgeries than had ever been done before. Every time they went back to the pharmacy, behind a box at the bottom of some container, there was something else that could be used. One day, a guy pulled up and said, hey, the doctors in whatever the big town was that I can't pronounce the name closest to us heard what you were doing and said, maybe you could use some of these, and they dropped them off. God will provide. Principles, little is much, and much can be little. Where is God? If God is in it, little is much. If God is not in it, much isn't worth much. That's a key principle. Influence, how you doing in influence? You can influence others around you. You have children, you have neighbors, you have coworkers. How you doing it? And last of all, time. There is one resource all of us have the same amount of. Today when you woke up, we were all given the same. You didn't get more than I got. God didn't show favor on me and give me more than you. We all have 24 hours today. What are we going to do with it? None of us can save today's minutes and transform them into tomorrow's hours. We must choose wisely how we use them today. Stewardship is what a person does after we say, I believe. Stewardship is not leaving a tip on God's tablecloth. It's the confession of an unpayable debt at God's Calvary. French fries. Next time you eat one, ask yourself the question, is all that I am and is all that I own, is it God's? What difference does that make in the way I live? It made a difference in the first century, and the church turned the world upside down. If it makes a difference in us in this century, we can turn it upside down again. Let's pray. Our Father, it's not a subject I enjoy, but it's a subject that is so very important. When you gave your son, you gave your all, you gave the best. Father, we often only take the best and we hold out from you everything else. But you want our all. You want our debts as well as our abilities. You want our good days as well as our bad days. You want our health as well as our sickness. Help us realize you make the difference in both. Father, I pray that each of us will have hearts to listen to your voice, to understand what you're saying to us. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. God bless you. Have a great day. Hope to see you back tonight, 6 o'clock for baptism.